Whether it's a psychopath trying to explain what drove him to murder his 4-year-old sister, or a serial killer on a cooking show. Here are 5 of the creepiest and most disturbed guests to appear on British TV shows. Now, before we begin, we as a species are constantly searching for new modes of escapism, for new ways to challenge ourselves and reap the rewards of our own development. Sports, competition, and video games are perfect methods in obtaining those objectives. But in a world where the gaming landscape is always evolving, it can be hard to find that next great platform to push yourself to the next level. If that's you, then look no further, because we are proud to announce Skill Gaming as sponsors for today's video. Skill Gaming is the premier place online to play all of your favorite games and engage with a community of fellow gamers. Whether it be indie or mainstream titles, with Skill Gaming, you can actually make money by depositing cash and playing games in dual mode, which are player versus player challenges. 1v CPU mode, which sees you play against an AI, or war mode, a 24-hour window that rewards top 3 finishers with their average high scores. And if you aren't interested in wagering money, then no worries, you can simply play games to build XP and top the leaderboards for bragging rights. What makes Skill Gaming so revolutionary is their platform is just as pro-developer as it is pro-gamer. They have an amazing developer program, where game devs can upload their games and actually make money when others play them. Alongside this program, Skill Gaming adds multiple new games each week, so you'll never grow tired of their library. But that's not all. Right now, through our special partnership with them, they are hosting a £1,000 competition just for the Top 5's community. All you need to do is sign up for Skill Gaming and compete for the prize money by playing games in XP mode around the world. No cash deposit or entry fee required. To qualify and claim the award, just be sure to follow and tweet at the Skill Gaming Twitter account by submitting a screenshot of your score for the game called Timberkek. Timberkek is addictively fun, and in order to be in for a chance of winning the £1,000, you need to get the highest score between now and the 26th of June on Timberkek. We'll be announcing the winner on the 26th in a Top 5's video. Again, this is just for the Top 5's community. You can also add us on there. Our username is TheKing with a capital G at the end. So, join Skill Gaming today, and finally achieve that escape into a world of lights-out competition and fun, with the chance of winning £1,000, or your country's equivalent. And now, hit those lights, sit back, and enjoy. Tracie Andrews. Andrews was born in 1969 in the West Midlands, England. By 1994, she was a 25-year-old single parent with aspirations of becoming a model. In October of 1994, Tracie met Lee Harvey at Ritz's nightclub in Birmingham, and the attractive couple soon became inseparable, moving in together after just 3 months. Harvey was a bus driver who also had a child from a previous relationship. The couple were both possessive and controlling, and neighbours reported that they were often heard screaming and shouting at each other in the early hours. They split up several times, and Tracie would throw Lee out with his possessions before changing the locks. But the couple would always reconcile, and despite their volatile relationship, after just 6 months of meeting, they decided to become engaged. Police had to be called to their flat multiple times during their 2-year relationship, as they had both assaulted one another on numerous occasions. Family members from both sides advised the couple that they should stay away from one another because of their aggressive arguments. Tracie was seen as the more volatile of the two, and was described by previous boyfriends as easily provoked, intense, and having a wicked temper. On the 30th of November 1996, the couple had, once again, been arguing fiercely all day. They decided to try and resolve their issues, so they went for a drive to a local pub. On the way back to their flat, they drove through a rural area called Cooper's Hill. Andrews later claimed that a dark Ford Sierra car began to follow them, and Lee began a cat-and-mouse chase with the car until it finally pulled in front of them, causing them to stop. Both Harvey and the driver got out of their vehicles, and Tracie could hear them arguing. The driver got back into the car, and a passenger got out. He went over and began to attack Harvey. So Andrews got out of the car and ran to his defense, but the man hit her in the face and knocked her to the ground. When she eventually regained consciousness, she saw that Harvey was lying in the road covered in blood. She went over to him and cradled him as he died. Harvey's car had come to a halt outside a property known as Keeper's Cottage, The resident there took Andrews inside while they called the police. Lee Harvey died at the scene from blood loss. He had been stabbed 42 times in a brutal and sustained attack. Many of the stab wounds were in Harvey's back. A massive murder hunt began, and there was huge media interest, so a televised press conference was called in the hope that someone would have some information about the road rage killer, who Tracie described as being fat with staring eyes. Andrews looked very much like the distressed victim, with two black eyes and a cut nose. She appealed for help to find the killer, but made a mistake when answering a question about the time that the couple had left the public house. This led police to suspect that she was not telling the truth. Take a look at some of the footage.
Good afternoon. Detectives investigating the murder of a man in last week's so-called road rage attack have arrested a 27-year-old woman. Lee Harvey was stabbed to death in a country lane. His fiancée was with him when he died.
An evening in the pub with her boyfriend ended in death. According to 27-year-old Tracie Andrews, she left the pub with Lee Harvey in his Ford Escort. She told police they overtook another car which gave chase. At a press conference, she described what happened to them.
It was a case of both Lee and the other person were like playing cat and mouse with each other.
Tracie Andrews said Lee Harvey was stabbed to death by a passenger in the second car. An hour ago, West Mercia police said they had arrested a 27-year-old woman. Jackie Rowley, BBC News.
Andrews attempted suicide a day later. Forensic evidence was gathered, which also pointed to Andrews as the actual murderer. Her clothes were analysed, and the bloody impressions of a penknife could be seen in her boot, where she had hidden the murder weapon for disposal later. Witnesses who were driving in the opposite direction as the incident occurred came forward and were able to confirm that they had both seen the white Escort that Harvey and Andrews were travelling in. They saw no other vehicles on the road at the time. Andrews was arrested while still in hospital and stood trial at Birmingham Crown Court. Although she maintained her innocence throughout, she was found guilty of murder on the 29th of July 1997 and sentenced to life imprisonment with a recommendation that she serve at least 14 years. In 1999, Andrews confessed in a letter to her solicitor that she had killed Lee Harvey, but she insisted that it had been in self-defense. She was a model prisoner and was released in 2011. She was given a new identity and plastic surgery to change her appearance and help hide her identity. Stephen Port. On June 19, 2014, the body of Anthony Walgate, who was 23, was found propped up in a sitting position on Cook Street in Barking, East London. A man named Stephen Port rang 999 to report seeing an unconscious man on the street. When quizzed by police, Port changed his story several times and was convicted of perverting the course of justice. He had hired Walgate as an escort, and when Walgate died of an overdose in his flat, Port dumped his body nearby. He was imprisoned for 8 months, but released after just two. Port went on to murder another three men between the end of August 2014 and September 2015. Gabrielle Cavari, Daniel Whitworth, and Jack Taylor. All of their bodies were found close to Port's flat, and two of the men were found in a nearby churchyard by the same dog walker. Port was selecting and grooming the men through the dating site Grindr, and after taking them to his flat, he would give them a fatal dose of the party drug, GHB, before raping them. Although the deaths were very similar, police did not make a connection between Port and the young men. They were working up the assumption that the men had overdosed accidentally whilst using GHB. Port even wrote and placed a strange suicide note in Daniel's hand, which framed him for Gabrielle's murder. And although Daniel's autopsy showed underarm bruising, as though he had been dragged, police did not check the sheet that he was wrapped in or the so-called suicide note for DNA. It was at this time that 41-year-old Port appeared on the BBC programme Celebrity MasterChef, a yearly cookery competition where celebrities compete to win the title in the UK. Port can be seen in an episode from the 9th series of the show. During one part of the competition, contestants have to prove that they can cope with the challenges of mass catering. JB Gill, a member of the boy band JLS, and EastEnders actor Emma Barton were cooking pasta and meatballs for 100 workers at the West Ham bus garage in East London. Port can clearly be seen wearing a blonde toupee and chef's whites, grinning at the camera as he helps the contestants to serve the workers. Philpott worked at the garage for 13 years, and by the time of filming, he was already a rapist and a murderer. Eventually, links between the young men and Port were made by police when he was spotted on CCTV with Jack Taylor. Port's DNA was found on the sheet and note discovered with Daniel's body. In November 2016, Port was tried at the Old Bailey in London and convicted for the assault, rape and murder of all four victims. The rape of three other men, 10 counts of administering a substance with intent, and 4 sexual assaults. He was given a whole of life order. In 2019, Gerald Motuvu, who supplied Port with GHB, was sentenced to 31 years in prison for murdering the actor Eric Mickles under very similar circumstances. Stuart Hazell. During the summer break of 2012, the local community in New Addington, South London, began a desperate search for 12-year-old schoolgirl Tia Sharp. Tia had stayed at her grandmother's house on the Thursday night before she went missing. It was something that she regularly did. Tia had left the house on the following morning to go into nearby Croydon to meet a friend and buy some shoes. She was due to come home at 7 p.m. that Friday, but never returned. Christine Bicknell was Tia's grandmother, and she lived with a man named Stuart Hazell. For a short time, Hazell had dated Tia's mother, Natalie Sharp, but they split up after a couple of weeks, and he began seeing Natalie's mother, Christine. Although he was 10 years younger than Christine, the relationship worked, and he moved into her home on the Linden Estate in New Addington in 2007. Over the next 5 years, he developed a close bond with Tia, and she began to call him Grandad. Because Hazell was the last person to see Tia, he became the main suspect into her disappearance. But this was disregarded when his neighbour, Paul Meehan, came forward and said that he was 100% sure that he had seen Tia coming out of her grandmother's house and walking towards the bus stop on the Friday morning, just as Hazell had said. The community on the Linden Estate rallied around and organised a huge search, and there was a lot of media interest. Thousands of posters and leaflets bearing Tia's photograph were handed out, and Hazell was seen out with searchers on the estate wearing a missing t-shirt. There was no CCTV of Tia on any of the buses into Croydon the day she went missing, and police could find no other eyewitnesses to corroborate Hazel's story. Once again, the police turned their attention to the last person that had seen Tia alive. They searched Hazel's home for a third time with cadaver dogs on Wednesday the 8th of August, although once again nothing was found. It was at this point that Hazell agreed to take part in a TV interview for ITV News, a popular news channel in the UK.
Just sat down here, right in the chair with Dave, where you are now, Dave. Sitting there watching telly. She picked up your mum's DS up, played the DS for a little while. I said, well, we're going to have some breakfast. So I made her some toast, and she had the toast, and then she wanted a sausage roll, because she's always eating sausage rolls. Basically, then she was sitting there. She doesn't take her washing up out, so I took her washing up out. Just started doing a bit of washing up in the kitchen. She was in there. She was telling me what she was doing, but I weren't really logging it into my head. Remember, like the kids, they talk to you, it goes in one ear, stays there for a second, it goes out, you know what I mean? Then I was washing up. As I was hoovering, then she walked out, she walked past me from the front room to go out, and she walked out the front door, that is all I know. And she left her bloody phone on charge, because I told her to sit there and leave her phone on charge. I didn't mean leave it on charge, because what's Tia doing? She plays on the BB thing, but then she uses it as it's charging, so there's no charge going through to it. So when I said to her, just leave your phone on charge, it means leave her phone on charge, not use it, let it charge up a bit, then you can actually take it with you or whatever, because she's been responsible to go to Croydon before. She's been responsible to go on trains and buses and trams and everything before on her own. Not so much trains, but trams and buses. She's done it all on her own, and it was just an everyday thing, you know? It's just that one time you want to bloody listen to her and you just don't. She said, goodbye. Well, I said, well, make sure you're back at 6. She went, yeah. And that was it, and then the door closed and she walks out.
And tell me a little bit about Tia's life. I mean, is she a happy girl? Is she jolly? Has she got any problems?
No, she's got no problems at all. She's a happy-go-lucky golden angel. You know what I mean? She's perfect. There's no arguments, no nothing, no nothing we can think of, absolutely nothing. They asked me stupid questions yesterday, like, oh, did you do anything to her? Well, no, I bloody didn't. Excuse my language, but no, I didn't. I'd never think of that. I'd loved her to bits. She's like my own daughter, for God's sake. We had that sort of relationship. It was that sort of thing. It was just, you know, she wanted it, she got it. She's got a lovely, loving home. She's never gone without anything, so I can't work it out. What the hell's going on? Well, if they believe what they read in the papers, they can do whatever they like, because I know deep down in my heart that Tia walked out of my house. She walked out of there, and I know damn well, because she was seen walking down the pathway. I know she made that track down to that way. What happened after that is, I don't know. And I wasn't the last person to see her, because the last person to see her was the one walking down the pathway. Tia, come on, babe. Come on, come and eat your dinner. I want my £10 back from my garden.
Yeah, we love you, babe. Come back to normal. There's nothing. It's going to be back to normal. Just come home and be back in the family. She's part of the family. Come home. Nothing's changed. No one's in trouble. Come home.
Hazell went into a lot of detail during the interview about Tia's movements before she left the house and denied any knowledge of her disappearance. At one point, he described Tia as a golden angel and perfect. Looking directly at the camera, he begged Tia to come home, referring to her as babe. On Friday the 10th of August, Tia's grandmother noticed a bad smell coming from the house, which was cleared and once again searched for a fourth time by police. Tia's body was found in the attic, wrapped in bin liners. Because of decomposition, the coroner was unable to establish a cause of death. Hazell had left the house early that morning and not returned. He was spotted buying vodka on CCTV at a supermarket and was later found drunk by a police dog in an area of Parkland. Tia's killer had been right in front of the media the whole time. A memory card was found in the home that contained explicit photos of Tia after her death. In May 2013, Hazell was found guilty of murder and sentenced to life imprisonment with a minimum term of 38 years. In early 2015, Paul Meehan, who had given a false statement to the police, was convicted of wasting police time and sentenced to 5 months in prison. Paris Bennett. Piers Morgan has interviewed several convicted murderers for documentaries such as Confessions of a Serial Killer and Killer Women. In 2019, he recorded The Psychopath about the child murderer Paris Bennett. This time the interview could not be held face to face. Instead, Pierce and his team were placed behind toughened glass with armed guards present. When Morgan questioned why this was necessary, he was told that Bennett was too dangerous. The filming took place in America, where Bennett is serving a prison sentence for the murder of his 4-year-old sister, a murder that he committed when he was just 13 years old. Bennett had been diagnosed a psychopath and has an IQ of 141, which is genius level. At the time of the murder, Bennett showed no signs of his psychopathy. He excelled in school and was a loving brother to his younger sister, Ella. He decided that he wanted to punish his mother for unknown reasons, but instead of murdering her, he thought that it would be much better to murder his sister. That way, his mother would lose both of her children because Ella would be dead and he would go to prison. He decided that it was the ultimate punishment. In February of 2007, while his mother, Charity, was at work in Abilene, Texas, Bennett manipulated his babysitter into leaving early. In a cold and deliberate act, he then went into his sister's room where she was sleeping, and after sexually assaulting her, he beat her and stabbed her repeatedly. He then rang a friend and chatted for over 10 minutes before dialing 911 and admitting what he had done. He even pretended to perform CPR on Ella while he spoke to the dispatcher, when really, he was just walking around the house with the phone. Despite this, his mother Charity still visits him regularly, stating that she loves her children unconditionally and doesn't know how to stop loving Paris. But Charity now has a new son called Phoenix, and she is worried that Bennett may come after them both if he is released.
I remember that a male officer walking past me into the bedroom, and I remember hearing him mutter, "Oh my God," when he saw what I had done. And I remember, I just felt like I was drowning in shame, knowing that they saw what I had done and knew that I had done it.
During the interview, Bennett insists that he is not a monster and that he loves his sister. And although he has never met Phoenix, he claims that he loves him too. He says he is redeemable and what he did 13 years ago was a mistake. although when asked by Morgan if he knows what love is, his chilling answer is, "I don't know how to answer that." Bennett was sentenced to 40 years for his crime, but because it was committed when he was a juvenile, he was eligible for parole in 2017 when he'll be in his 30s. Experts believe that it would be a mistake to release Bennett, as psychopathy cannot be cured, only managed by keeping the psychopath locked up. Throughout the interview, Bennett speaks in a measured and unemotional way, explaining that he has been honest in admitting that he has a dark side, but he is adamant he can control it if he is set free. Morgan says he has never felt as chilled in a bad way as he was by that guy, because he was so intelligent. Bennett is said to be more cunning and more manipulative than any other criminal Morgan had ever met before. Mick Philpott. One man who developed a taste for the media spotlight was Mick Philpott, known to the public as Shameless Mick. He first appeared on the Jeremy Kyle show with his wife in 2007 to demand a bigger council house for his growing brood of children. The British talk show was extremely popular at the time and dealt with issues of family and relationships. By then, Philpott had already been convicted of the attempted murder of a former girlfriend. Once he shot her in the groin with a crossbow because he thought her skirt was too short. In 2006, by the time he was 50, Philpott had fathered 17 children. He lived with his wife, who was 25, his girlfriend, who was 22, and their 11 children in a three-bedroom council house in Victory Road, Derby. Lisa, his girlfriend, was Philpott and Mairead's bridesmaid at their wedding. She was only 16 and pregnant with Philpott's child at the time. Philpott chose to live in a caravan in the garden rather than the house. There, his wife and mistress would visit him on alternate nights to be what he called serviced. He had complete control over the two women. Philpott then appeared on a program about the benefit culture where he bragged that he didn't need to work because he was taking wages from both his wife and girlfriend and claiming over £50,000 a year in benefits. In early 2012, Lisa decided that she had had enough of Philpott's controlling and violent behavior, and she was able to get away, taking her five children with her. Philpott was livid that Lisa had defied him, and he began a legal battle to get the children back. He decided that he would set fire to the house while the children were still inside and frame Lisa for it. The idea was that he would rescue the children and become a hero. Then he could win the custody battle, be given a bigger house, and reclaim the children's benefits. At about 4 a.m. on the 11th of May 2012, together with his wife and friend Paul Moseley, Philpott pulled petrol through the letterbox of the house and set the fire. It quickly got out of control, trapping and killing five of his children, who all died at the scene. Their half-brother, who was 13, also died in hospital 2 days later. Lisa was arrested but quickly released through lack of evidence. Police would begin to suspect that Philpott was actually the culprit. Philpott displayed bizarre behavior at both the hospital when visiting his son and at the morgue when he went to identify the children's bodies. There he proceeded to flirt with the female staff members and make inappropriate sexual comments. Never one to miss an opportunity to grab the spotlight, Philpott insisted on having a press conference on May 16th. With his wife sitting beside him, Philpott proceeded to thank the police, fire and emergency services, and neighbours, but never mentioned the children at all. He frequently dabbed his eyes with a tissue, as he pretended to cry, but the tissue remained dry throughout. Ironically, he ended the conference by asking for privacy, so that he and his wife could grieve.
And we can't express our gratitude to everybody that's been concerned with the case, with what's been going on. I've actually been down to our home, and what we saw, we just cannot believe it. We grew up in a community that's been had a lot of problems with violence and God knows what else, and to see this community to come together like that, it's just too overwhelming.
Desperate now to find evidence and prove what they believed to be true, the police bugged the couple's hotel room. This picked up incriminating conversations. Added to this, forensic analysis found liquid petrol on the clothing of all three suspects. Although the charges were reduced from murder to manslaughter because all three of the defendants hadn't meant to kill the children, they were all found guilty. Philpott received a life sentence with a minimum term of 15 years. Mairead and Moseley were each sentenced to 17 years. Mareda was released in 2010 after serving half of her sentence. So that's it for this video. We would like to send out our deepest sympathies to all the families and friends of the victims mentioned in this video. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.